We want to solve the given log equations, but these two equations are a little bit different than the previous examples because notice how each term is a logarithm. So normally, we combine the logarithms and then write the log equation as an exponential equation. But in this case, after we combine the logarithms, we will not have to convert the log equation to an exponential equation because if we can write the log equation in the form where we have one logarithm equal to another logarithm with the same base, for example, in this form here, then we can conclude that the number of parts of the logarithms must be equal, or in this case, x must equal y. So looking at this first equation, notice how each logarithm is a common log, which means it's log base 10. So the first step here will be to combine the logarithms on the right. And since we have a sum of two logs with the same base, we'll use the product property of logarithms here to combine the two logs, which means because we have a sum, we are going to multiply the number part of the logarithms together. So the left side will be the same. On the right side, common log x plus common log 5 is equal to the common log of
x times 5, or 5x.
Again, now notice how we have two logs with the same base equal to each other, and therefore the number parts of the logarithms must be equal, meaning x plus 5 must equal 5x. So now to solve for x, we'll subtract x on both sides. So we'll have 5 equals 4x. Divide both sides by 4. So we have 5/4 equals x, or we can say x equals 5/4. But before we decide this is our solution, we should take a look back at the original equation to determine the possible values for x. What I mean by that is, remember the number part of a logarithm has to be greater than 0.
So looking at these two logarithms,
notice how the domain of common log x is the most restrictive domain, meaning x must be greater than 0. And since 5/4 is greater than 0, we can conclude that this is our solution. Notice how the domain of this logarithm would be x is greater than negative 5, but x being greater than 0 is more restrictive. So this is the only interval we do need to check. Now let's take a look at our second example. Notice how each logarithm is natural log, or log base e. Our first step will be to combine the two logarithms on the left side. Again, notice how we have a sum, so we can combine these by multiplying the number parts of the logarithms. Natural log x plus natural log of the quantity x minus 4 is equal to natural log of x times x minus 4. This is still equal to natural log 3x. Let's go ahead and multiply this out by distributing the x. So we have natural log of x squared minus 4x equals natural log 3x. Again, notice how now we have two logarithms with the same base equal to each other, and therefore the number parts of the logs must be equal, meaning x squared minus 4x must equal 3x. So now we'll solve for x. Notice how now we have a quadratic equation. So we'll set this equal to 0 and see if we can factor it. So we'll subtract 3x on both sides. So we have x squared minus 7x equals 0. Remember, the first step in factoring is to factor out the greatest common factor, which in this case would be x. So we have x times the quantity x minus 7 equals 0. So this quadratic equation has two solutions, x equals 0 or x equals 7. But again, we can't just assume that this log equation has two solutions. We need to consider the domain for each logarithm. Again, which means the number part of the logarithms must always be greater than 0. And in this case, this logarithm here has the most restrictive domain. Notice how x has to be greater than 4. For these two, x has to be greater than 0. But this is the most restrictive domain, so our solution must be in this interval. We'll notice how x equals 0 would not be in this interval, and therefore cannot be one of our solutions. But But notice how 7 is greater than 4. Therefore, our solution is x equals 7. Okay, I hope you found this helpful.